astronaut Gus Grissom. A report of Grissom's recovery, who switched now to Cape Canaveral, and ABC science editor Jules Bergman.
This is ABC science editor Jules Bergman at Cape Canaveral. Just flown in from the aircraft carrier USS Randolph out in the Atlantic Ocean. The first film to the recovery of our second astronaut, Captain Gus Grissom of the Air Force. And in just a few seconds, we'll be ready to roll that tape, which has just landed a few seconds ago from a jet Navy plane from the aircraft carrier. Now let's have a look at the tape. And here you see the first shots ever seen of Captain Grissom's capsule descending by parachute into the Atlantic. The main chute is open. He's almost at the water coming in. Now, this scene from the aircraft carrier Randolph as sailors and officers anxiously await the helicopter carrying Captain Grissom back from the Atlantic. With me is ABC Pentagon correspondent Robert Lodge, who was stationed aboard the aircraft carrier when Commander Alan Shepard made his historic first flight last May 5th. Bob, how far off does the helicopter look there?
Right at this point, it's very hard to see. Just a small dot there above the deck, Jules, about an inch on our screen, or an inch and a half. I would guess it's at least 4 or 5 miles away. If that recovery of Captain Grissom.
They look as excited and as anxious as they were with Shepard.
I didn't hear a report whether there was a cheer that went up today, but I do know a tremendous cheer went up aboard the Lake Champlain when Alan Shepard was recovered. Of course, I think our view of the Shepard recovery was much better from the Champlain than it was today on the USS Randolph, because the parachute opened almost directly above the Champlain, the main parachute, and we could see him floating almost all the way down to the horizon. At most, he was 4 or 5 miles away from the ship. Today, I understand, Captain Grissom's spacecraft landed quite a bit farther away from the USS Randolph.
Reportedly, at least 6 to 7 miles away, Bob.
Yes, I understand that's the figure. The helicopters today sighted the spacecraft, Captain Grissom's spacecraft, about a minute before landing, we were told later.
Well, Bob, this is this scene of waiting on the carrier deck, as undramatic as it looks, is actually, as we've now found out, one of great high drama, because at this point, no one on the deck of the carrier quite knew what had happened. We'd seen, as we did here, the spacecraft of Captain Grissom descending on his large 62-foot parachute, and we saw it splash in the water, but there ensued this 6 or 7 or 8 minute time lag, and then the capsule was seen to sunk, and no one knew exactly what had happened.
Well, apparently, from what we can piece together, and there are still a lot of questions to be answered by Captain Grissom himself and by the pilot and co-pilot of the recovery helicopter, but apparently from what we can piece together here at Cape Canaveral, what happened was that, first of all, Captain Grissom had not finished the checkout of all the instruments inside. He made radio contact with the recovery helicopter as it came close to his spacecraft and asked them to stand by while he finished checking out the instruments.
Well, as you notice at the news conference, Bob, there's still some confusion about that point. When I raised that question myself and Commander Shepard answered it this morning, Captain Grissom apparently was not checking out the instruments. He had to push certain buttons to stop certain recording data machines, but mainly he was apparently getting out of his parachute harness and his straps and rig. We still hear these Marine detachment and the sailors aboard the Randolph still have no idea what happened at this particular point in time while the helicopter was struggling to recover Captain Grissom and to recover the Mercury spacecraft Liberty Bell 7. As I said before, all they could see from the deck far in the distance, 6, 7, 8 miles away, was that the capsule was slowly seen to sink. And Grissom was seen struggling, and now we find out he actually swam 65 to 70 feet before he was rescued, and in the In that heavy 20-pound mercury pressure suit, as Commander Shepard noted this morning, this can be done, but it is not an easy chore.
An unanswered question is, why did he not inflate a raft, which is the usual procedure for that type of eventuality?
It seems to me, Bob, that there are several unanswered questions that Grissom himself will have to answer when we get to see him tomorrow or Sunday.
Yes, Jules. Now, what apparently happened was that the Marine helicopter hovering overhead did not try to hook on to the spacecraft until after Captain Grissom got out. Then he got out because apparently water had taken in quite a bit of water inside the cabin itself, and he was about to sink. And he got out just in time, we are told. Then the helicopter hooked onto the spacecraft, all right, and tried to pull it up out of the water. It had already started to sink, and the helicopter strained for 2 or 3 minutes to try and pull it up. Now, I just talked to Lieutenant Wayne Kuhn, who was the recovery pilot for the Shepard recovery in May. He is here at Cape Canaveral today, and he told me that helicopter, which is exactly the same type of helicopter he was piloting on May 5th, has 5 minutes of maximum recovery, maximum hovering power.
Right.
In other words, if they had waited the full 5 minutes and tried to pull that capsule up out of the water, it would have the helicopter would have gone in itself.
Right, Bob. But the critical thing here, and the unanswered thing for viewers who may have missed the beginning of this special videotape telecast of the recovery of Captain Grissom, the critical thing is that no one knew at this point exactly what was happening. There was a splash, and the capsule descended into the water and then began to sink. And from 7 miles away, both the radio communications from the helicopter to the carrier Randolph and the long-range picture were confused. What we're seeing now, of course, which may add to the suspense or confusion, are some of the videotapes late. We haven't had time to edit any of this videotape. We rushed it right into our ABC studios here to put it on the air because we think the American people want to see this dramatic recovery.
Now, here we're starting apparently a second reel of videotape. Now the helicopters, the three helicopters,
There's actually four, Bob.
There are only two primary recovery helicopters, of course. One picked up Grissom, and one tried to pick up the spacecraft and finally had to cut it loose and let it sink into the ocean, into 2,800 fathoms of water. Highly unrecoverable
right. And,
now.
What may have happened, Bob, as one of the helicopter people here told me, it isn't always as easy to sense the winch on the helicopter as you think. Now, there's the primary chopper in there.
I can see the
dragging the capsule.
I can
dragging
see
the capsule.
This must be just the point. It's trying to pull it up out of the water. And
right, and it's got it a bit out, but you can see the capsule is already flooding.
Yes.
Already just beginning to sink.
Now, on the second helicopter, that is the one where Captain Grissom is riding. He swam, as Jules said, about 65 feet away and was recovered by the second helicopter. Now, the first helicopter, the one on the right in our picture, is still trying to pull the spacecraft up.
Now, as you can
see, it's going deeper into the water at this point.
Well, it has it upright at this point, but the water itself is acting as a leveling agent on the capsule, and it slowly seems to be descending now. The shot is somewhat in the distance, but I think we're... No, there seems to be making another effort to pull it out. This is when his engine began to overheat. Virgil Grissom back to the deck for the carrier USS Randolph today. Just hardly more than an hour and a half ago. Right, and the helicopter seems to be circling for a landing and dropping in now. Some of those background noises we've been hearing, Bob, are the actual natural deck sound from the Randolph, the crew and the command being done. Here's the chopper in, and there's a marine bomber. This looks like the one with Grissom. The cable, the helicopter was firmly on its capsule and blew the hatch out before it really was on, and then the water came rushing in.
I'm pretty sure that this is the helicopter.
Co-pilot rescue specialist at the door.
The helicopter sets down on the deck. We'll be able to tell which one Grissom is in because
right.
The NASA doctors and Space Administration doctors on the ship will immediately go out to the helicopter to greet Captain Grissom. Apparently, judging by what's hanging down below, there is the one that tried to bring the spacecraft out of the water. I wouldn't be surprised if this is the one that...
I think we were disillusioned here, but Captain Gus Grissom, a little bit late, Bob, we're witnessing...
That picture being so jumpy was that it was an extremely long-range lens, thinking this is still probably at least 5 or 6 or 7 miles away from
the
ship.
And just to the left of the number one rescue helicopter that has the line on the Mercury capsule is the second helicopter, which picked up Captain Grissom. We're still waiting to get a look at that. Now, here's a closer shot, and the capsule...
A little jumpy, but you can see the capsule very clearly. It's almost completely out of the water.
No, it's in a bit, I'm afraid, Bob, and it's also tilted to one side. And the Mercury capsule normally, with that hatch secured, would rise somewhat higher out of the water. At least in the egress tests I've seen done at Langley Field, it does.
It has a water bag on the bottom, which is supposed to fill as it hits the water, and that helps it to float. But because the side hatch was open, the spacecraft took in a lot of water. Grissom got out just in time, and I talked to a Navy officer as well as Marine Lieutenant Wayne Coons, a recovery pilot himself, who recovered Alan Shepard in May, and he told me there was no doubt in his mind, but they still wanted to be sure and double-check. It was all the water that was taken inside the cabin itself that is making it so hard here, as you can see on the screen, for them to pull that helicopter, that spacecraft, up out of the water and return it to the ship.
He's got it most of the way out now, but he's putting every bit of strain he can on his engine to do it. And just a review for any viewers who may have heard, the recovery of America's newest astronaut, our second man in space, of the Air Force, who made his historic journey today. What we're witnessing here is a group of four rescue helicopters from the aircraft carrier Randolph, the helicopter that rescued Grissom, and another one that valiantly tried to salvage his Mercury spacecraft, but is running into trouble, as we can see.
As well as two standby helicopters.
Right.
The one trying to retrieve the spacecraft was on the extreme right. Now the one carrying Grissom has passed it and is on the right now. Apparently is coming back into the ship. The deck of the carrier, USS Randolph, was in the foreground of our picture just a moment ago.
Right.
Now, at this point, you can see the spacecraft has been cut loose because the number two helicopter, the one trying to retrieve the spacecraft, has risen quite a bit out of the water.
Now, this looks like it may be the number one helicopter carrying Captain Grissom back to the Randolph.
I'm sure that they would probably land Captain Grissom first. I'm not sure what the number of
the vessel to get to the sea.
It had a distance of at least 7 miles to close after the spacecraft hit the water, I understand. Even though the spacecraft did overshoot it by about 15 miles.
Yes. And the other point here, as Walt Williams, Project Mercury Operations Director, made not long ago at a news conference here, is that these Marine rescue pilots know their business. Something went wrong there in the cycle. Captain Grissom perhaps put on the extra weight load.
Got a much clearer view now.
Right.
It was only a matter of 2 or 3 minutes before they had to cut it loose. Now it's almost completely out of the water, but it was at this point that the Marine pilots realized that their maximum hovering power was almost used up, and they had to cut it loose.
Well, he's got that Mercury spacecraft, old Liberty Bell 7, which we'll never see again, just about completely out of the water now, but...
As we can see, all this
action is still taking place a fair distance off, despite the fact that the carrier seemed at maximum speed, and the carrier is a fast.
First videotape of the recovery of Captain Virgil Grissom today on the carrier, the USS Randolph. There goes the NASA, the Space Administration recovery team.
Right.
Two doctors right out to meet him.
There's Grissom coming out now, his pressure suit, and you can see his hair is still wet and his pressure suit is wet and he looks kind of blurry-eyed right here.
Two doctors now to tape record everything he says during his debriefing. At this point, Grissom is supposed to have said, "Give me a handkerchief to blow my nose. My head is full of salt water."
Right.
His head looks wet either from sweat or from the dunking he got in the sea. He did have a swim there, so that is, of course, why it's wet.
But Gus looks none the worse for wear in this thing, Bob.
Now over to a special ladder where he'll climb, it's just a short ladder, down to the captain's in-port cabin where the debriefing took place. These tapes were just rushed in from the carrier Lake Champlain by Navy plane.
The rescue itself, the recovery itself, rather, which almost became a rescue, took place less than 2.5 hours ago out in the Atlantic. This is perhaps a new record for getting live television action back on back to the public on the air.
Unedited videotape. Those are cameramen there we see on the screen who recorded the whole recovery from above in helicopters for the Space Administration. Great feeling of exhilaration, I'm sure, on the deck of the carrier USS Randolph, in that they have successfully recovered Captain Virgil Grissom, America's second astronaut. The entire scientific value of the space shot is probably yet to be evaluated, but Jules, I would suspect that flight could be called almost a complete success, although they did lose by the letting the spacecraft sink, or by having the spacecraft sink, they did lose the films of the instruments during the flight and the pictures of Captain Grissom's face, his reactions to the flight. They do have all this other information recorded by means of telemetry, both here at Cape Canaveral and on Grand Bahama Island, and for that matter, from ships at sea.
Right.
So they say that the scientific value of the ship, of the space flight, was very, very slightly diminished by the loss of that spacecraft today.
After that preliminary physical exam, Bob, which was administered by Navy Commander Robert Laning and Army Captain Jerome Strong, and the debriefing using tape recorders, Grissom rested in the captain's cabin, which is a luxurious suite on the Randolph, a large living room, bedroom, galley and private bath, and rested there until his departure for Grand Bahama.
Incidentally, Commander Lanning and Captain Strong, a Navy and an Army doctor especially trained for this job by the Space Administration, were the same doctors that were aboard the carrier the USS Lake Champlain for the recovery of Alan Shepard on May 5th. So they're certainly experienced in what to expect and how to conduct a debriefing.
And those Marine rescue helicopters, number 30 and 32, were two of the same choppers used then too, Bob.
Well, it was the same type of machine, I'm told, Jules, but the pilot who actually recovered Alan Shepard was here today on Cape Canaveral. I just spoke to him about half an hour ago and tried to get some comparisons between the recovery of Captain Grissom and... Now, here's one of the destroyers in the recovery operation. It was thought at the time that it was going out to try and see if perhaps the spacecraft couldn't be recovered. That destroyer, I understand, is steaming into the waters where the spacecraft
was
lost.
That was the USS Coney, one of the outboard destroyers, and the USS Waller, the other one, was sent inboard. Was quickly sent to the scene, and they valiantly attempted to get a line aboard the sunken spacecraft, but it turned out that the Atlantic Ocean at that point is 2,800 fathoms deep.
We've lost picture again, barely ended another reel of videotape. This unedited videotape, just back from the, on the recovery of...
Film is coming up.
Well, next, Bob, we're going to have the unedited film of the actual recovery, apparently the close-up shots of Captain Gus Grissom, taken from number 30, taken from the helicopter that was coming up next aboard.
Taken from above.
Right.
By a newsreel cameraman.
And just in.
Yes, sir.
An interesting note, Bob, I see here in some of our dispatches is that despite Gus Grissom's dunking in the Atlantic, his first request after the debriefing was a glass of water.
not salt water, I'm sure. Here is the news film now, taken from a helicopter above.
Now, there's the winch line dangling down the left, the line that steel cable that should have lifted the spacecraft up once it got on. There's the capsule down below on its side, already sinking, apparently.
Taking in water.
kind of a hunt-and-pick game for the helicopter pilots to get that winch aboard, to get that line aboard the spacecraft.
The first job is to snip off the aerial from the radio in the spacecraft, and that is a tricky job, something like trimming trees, the high branches of trees. Then they hook the line on to pull the spacecraft up out of the water. But as we've said, the spacecraft was already...
Right. We're about to see a fairly lengthy struggle with the elements here and the forces of nature, Bob, in the attempt to salvage this spacecraft. That snipping of the radio antenna, as you know, is to prevent it from interfering with the helicopter's rotor blades. If they came down without snipping it, it might knock one of the rotors off or damage it.
What is that dangling on the right there?
That is one of the instrument or radio beacon packages from the top of the Mercury capsule, Bob, and that's perfectly normal for it to dangle that way. The lower left, I seem to see the picture window that Captain Grissom looked out of during his flight, and the hatch should be near. Now, here's an interesting note. No one's seen this before. The flotation bag, which acts as a sea anchor, as I explained earlier, is inflated and is working fine. It acts as a sea anchor, and it cushions some of the shock as the capsule crashes into the water at 32 feet per second. So one of my thoughts was perhaps that flotation bag had not worked properly, but I see it did work properly.
You can see that. I think that's the hatch on the right there, lower right, the hatch of the spacecraft.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems to me that it's already taken in quite a bit of water. It was the water that was taken into the cabin of the spacecraft itself that made the spacecraft too heavy, from all that we can determine, too heavy to recover. It was just more than that helicopter could pull out of the water and get back to the ship.
I'm not so sure, Bob, that it's taken any water so far. I think of it as
hatch. Isn't that an open hatch there on the right?
It looks like an open port of some kind. Now, maybe it's one of the smaller windows or periscope ports on the thing, but I can't see how it could have taken in water with a flotation bag still pretty much holding it above the sea.
What's that coming up now?
This coming down now is the shoulder harness. It's like a steeplejack harness that the astronaut puts around his waist under his arms. This physically is how he's lifted up from the helicopter, lifted up from the capsule into the helicopter. And as you can see, they've got it dangling down there now, waiting for Grissom to get hold of it by himself. Now, that was the hatch, you were right, and the hatch is open, but apparently the capsule hasn't taken any water, because I seem to have seen Captain Grissom's head there, didn't you?
Well, he stayed in the spacecraft for a while, until it seemed almost certain that it would sink. Actually, if this is the helicopter that tried to retrieve it, he did not climb into this helicopter from which these films are being taken. Now we've lost another roll of film. The next roll will be threaded up in just a moment, I'm sure.
Bill Shadell, can you hear us up there in New York?
I've been listening, Jules. It's very interesting, very interesting. There is one report, Jules. Hello, Jules.
Yes, Bill, I'm right here.
There is one report that the astronaut is saying his capsule filled with water after the side hatch blew off unexpectedly.
After the hatch blew off unexpectedly?
Yes, he said he didn't know why it happened. This is one report coming to us here.
Well, that is interesting, Bill, because that was a question I was going to ask at the news conference myself. Had there been a malfunction of that explosive bolt mechanism that separates the hatch from the spacecraft? And one of the answers that Walt Williams seemed to have come out with was that there had not been one. But I could not see from my own experience, a trained man like Gus Grissom could have inadvertently blown that hatch off knowing what would have happened.
Yes.
But that report is very interesting, Bill.
It doesn't say where it comes from, whether this is comes from the carrier or Grand Bahamas.
25 cents.
Bill, we're about to get a report direct from the Grand Bahamas in a few seconds. ABC correspondent Julian Anthony, who is down there, for the arrival of Captain Grissom, will be reporting to us in a little bit from there.
Captain Grissom has just arrived at Grand Bahama Island.
Let's go down now for Julian Anthony's report. Bill, we've been having a little bit of circumstance. circuit trouble there, and we had Anthony standing by. We understand we've just lost him for a little bit. So we'll continue on here until we get word from the engineers that we can switch down to Anthony.
Very well. You might be interested to know, of course, that President Kennedy watched the space flight on television, and then he phoned Grissom on the carrier to give him his personal congratulations. Also an interesting comment from Republican Senator Barry Goldwater of Arizona, who you know is a first-class pilot himself. He called the astronaut a great little fighter pilot.
Very good, Bill. Bill, forgive me for cutting you off, but we have word that Julian Anthony is standing by now on Grand Bahama Island. So we switch now to Grand Bahama and Julian Anthony.
This is Julian Anthony at the airstrip at Grand Bahama Air Force Base, where the two planes and the carrier, carrying Captain Grissom, have just arrived at the apron. Captain Grissom has emerged from the plane in civilian clothes. He's accompanied by the medical team from the carrier, Captain Jerome Strong and Commander Manning. Also with them are capsule technician Charles Piner. In the second plane from the carrier, the two pilots of the helicopter that dropped the missile, perhaps by accident or some malfunction, have also arrived. They're getting out of the plane. Colonel Powers, Operations Director of NASA Webb, have met Captain Grissom, are escorting him to a station wagon, along with Captain May, who's the commander of the air base here. Everybody appears in fine spirits. They'll be heading for the hospital, which is about a half a mile down the road here, through the typical thin pine trees that make up most of the island. They're in the station wagon now and are prepared to leave. A little earlier, Colonel Powers, who arrived here about a half hour before, I asked him for comment on about how operation had gone so far. And Colonel Powers said that right up to the point of losing the capsule, everything was perfect. In fact, he quoted Walter Williams at Mercury Control as saying that the flight was a major contribution to the American space program. Colonel Powers described the loss of the capsule as an extremely sad one for the film record and many of the other data that have been completely lost. He said the capsule was completely unrecoverable in 2,800 fathoms of water. That's about 3 miles down. They've all been here now. The station wagon is moving toward the hospital, and we expect that within a short time, perhaps within the next half hour, we will have a report from Colonel Powers and some of the others who are here for the final medical examination and debriefing of Captain Grissom. This is Julian Anthony on Grand Bahama Island.
Bill Shadell?
Yes, Jules.
This is Jules Bergman again at Cape Canaveral, and there we have another facet of the story, Captain Gus Grissom's arrival at Grand Bahama, the medical holding station in the Caribbean here, where he'll be checked over for the next day or day and a half before being returned to Cape Canaveral to the rest of Project Mercury. One last note, Bill, is that Grissom is very sober and serious about it. Now back to you, Bill.
Thanks very much, Jules Bergman at Cape Canaveral. ABC is bringing you the next chapter on the astronaut flight. Stay tuned to your ABC station throughout the day for later developments. This is Bill Shadell, ABC New York.
ABC TV has presented a special report from Cape Canaveral. We return now to our regularly scheduled programs.